Okay, so thanks again to being here. So we will have now the privilege to hear Professor José Martin Gago, who is a well-known specialist in X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. So it is our pleasure to be here today, and thank you for accepting to be part of this workshop. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for this introduction. And well, my name is José Martin Gago, and I am working at the Institute of Material Science of Madrid, although currently I am in the Czech Academy of Science making a long stay. So I am going to tell you about XPS. So that will be a general introduction to XPS, and I will try to convince you that XPS is a very nice technique to be used in different environments, and for sure you can take opportunity to use it for your research. So I will discuss a bit the technique, trying to avoid the most technical parts, the most theoretical parts. Okay, so first of all, to say that there are two different names for the same technique. XPS, X-ray photoemission spectroscopy, or ESCA, is exactly the same. Is the way that the physicist, normally they call it XPS, whereas chemists normally call it ESCA, but it's the same technique. And here are all the keywords for understanding how it's working the technique. First is a photoemission process. Second is a spectroscopy. That means, well, first thing is means that it's based on the photoelectric effect. A spectroscopy means that it's going to give you atomic elemental information, which is every atom that is on a material. Electron means that it's based on electrons, that you detect electrons, and chemical analysis that not only is going to give you which kind of atom, but also the chemical state of the atom. And finally, X-ray, meaning that you are irradiating your sample with X-ray. So a combination of all these words tell you everything about the technique. So let's go. First, some definitions that are important to have in mind. And it's the sampling depth. I mean, you have a material, and sampling depth is how deep in the material your signal is coming from. So of course, if you want to detect an emitting atom, you want to detect an electron or whatever is emitting this atom, you need that what is emitting this proof is getting out of the crystal of the material that you are studying without interacting with others. In the case that, this is a standard concept, and this is related with the mean free path, which is this average distance from one emitting electron, proton, light, whatever, from the emission to the scatter. So the typical mean free path in solid depend a lot on the proof. Light is very high because they interact a lot. X-rays, they are millimeters, much higher. Neutrons, centimeters, fast electrons, microns, but low energy electrons is the one that we are going to discuss. The mean free path, the average distance from the emission to the first collision, is very small. Okay, so normally this inelastic mean free path is called like that, have this kind of behavior. And this is a standard. This, every one of those points that you see in this curve corresponds to different measurements from different materials. So that's called kind of universal curve, in the sense that this is the mean free path. And that means that the electron kinetic energy is very low, let's say about 1 eV. The electron can travel a lot inside the material. If the electron energy is about 100 eV in this region, the electrons interact very fast with other electrons. And that means that it's going to travel just 1, 2, 3, 10 nanometers from the point it's emitted to the first interaction. And then when it interacts, it's going to change energy, and then it's not useful anymore. So this mean free path can be understood as the distance that has to travel. I mean, virtually, after this three times the mean free path, most of the electrons are vanished. So this is important because that is telling us that if we are working with electrons, as we do with XPS, the sampling depth is about three times the electron mean free path. And that means that the sampling depth of SBS is about 10, 20, 30 nanometers maximum. Everything that is going below this distance is invisible for you. You are not having information about that. So it's just, that means that XPS or ESCA is a technique that is giving you just superficial information. Okay. So a bit of a summary is a technique that is going to give you information about the presence or absence of a particular chemical element. We will see in this talk that it's possible also to have an idea of the concentration of this element and the chemical or the oxidation state of that. And that of everything that is on the surface. I mean, you have a microcrystal, large molecule, organic molecule. So all the information is coming from this region and this region in the surface. So the last layer and the last layers of a material. And maximum about 10 nanometers. Okay. So as I told you, it's based on the photoelectric effect. And you know, the photoelectric effect was proposed by Einstein as a quantum process in which the electrons take the energy from a photon and are able to travel into vacuum. Einstein demonstrated with this kind of experiments and introduced the photon concept. But we are not going to talk about that because this configuration was the first one. But the fact is that once the electrons are emitted, what I'm going to do is to try to understand which is the kinetic energy of those electrons, depending on the radiation energy. Well, a short history, of course, the basis, they are coming from the photoelectric effect, from the concept of photon, transfer of energy. Although the first analyzer was built very fast after the discovery of this kind of process. But the first spectra, as we know, in the XPS, it was taken on the 50s, on the past century, and the SIGBAM from the University of Ulm established finally the technique and won the Nobel Prize in 1967. Okay, as I told you, it's based on the photoelectric effect. What that means? Means that if you have an atom, you have an electron that is going to be kicked off, and then the energy of this electron is very easy to calculate because it should be the photon energy minus the binding energy. This is conservation of energy. And this is in a single isolated atom. In a single isolated atom, so also this emission, this photoelectron emission, is homogeneous in space. Many times you can just classify the techniques in the proof, the proof that you are, what you are sending and what you are taking out. And this technique can be classified as photon in, electron out, right? So the photon is absorbed and the electron is ejected out of the material. In fact, that is done in vacuum. You have a sample, you have an X-ray source, because we are going to work with X-rays. I will tell you why in a moment. And then in vacuum, we are going to have electrons emitted that we are going to measure the kinetic energy using an electron analyzer. But all that needs good vacuum. Why? Of course, if you have here air molecules, the air molecules, they are going to attenuate the signal, and then nothing is going to arrive to the detector. So this is a bit, you have radiation, X-ray radiation, you have electrons kicking it off, and that happens on vacuum, and you're going to measure the energy of those electrons. Okay, why is it spectroscopy? Well, it's a spectroscopy because, of course, the binding energy of our atom, for instance, here we have the binding energy of the level 1s of the different atoms, or the different elements. Here they are classified by atomic number, and you see that the binding energy is changing a lot with an atomic number. So if I am able to measure precisely which is the binding energy, I will know which is the atom. And this is the idea. All the electronic levels of an atom are tabulated. In the Fermi part, close to the Fermi energy, that's not working. But in the core levels, as we call that, they are well tabulated and well known. So this energy depends on the atom. And what we are going to do is to irradiate and material, form of different elements, and I will create a hole. I mean, one electron from a core level is going to absorb the energy of the photon and is going to be kicked out of the system. But now energy conservation can tell a lot of things. Here is an energy diagram. So this is the kinetic energy. This is the vacuum energy, and this is the binding energy referred to the Fermi. So the addition of this kinetic plus the vacuum plus the energy plus the binding energy have to give me the energy of the electron. So energy conservation tells me everything. The photon, the energy of the photon, is used to pass the electron from here to here, from here to here, and then to give a certain kinetic energy. And this kinetic energy is what I am going to measure with an electron analyzer. So, in fact, normally when I do that in a laboratory, I know which is the photon energy because I am using photons, for instance, X-rays, with a fixed photon energy. The binding energy is what I would like to know. Vacuum energy is more or less constant in most of the materials. Let's put 40 V, and then the kinetic energy. So there is a relationship between the binding energy and the kinetic. If I measure the kinetic, I know the binding, just from here, subtracting from the photon energy. So it's a very easy to do that. And then what I'm doing is that this electron, this emitted electron, is going to pass through, normally, an hemispherical analyzer and be detected by a detector at the other side. So only the electrons that have the correct energy, they're going to arrive to the end. If you have more energy, you will be crashing to this part. If your energy is lower than another one, it's crashing here. So only the precise electrons, the electrons with a precise kinetic energy, they're going to arrive to the detector. And like that, if I scan the voltages, I can make a distribution of the number of emitted electrons. And that is an XPS spectra. An XPS spectra is a distribution of emitted electrons as a function of the kinetic, it's what I measure here, and then transformed in binding energies. That this would give me the information about the material. Okay, as I told you, this is very interesting because if I see a peak in a spectrum, looking to the energy, the kinetic and the binding, I can know which is the peak where it's coming from, the element that from this electron is emitted. And here again, we have all these elements from sodium to chlorine here, and you see how the binding energy of the 1s peak is changing for chlorine and for sodium, right? So measuring the binding energy, the kinetic and then the binding, I know which is the element from where the electron is coming from. So elemental identification is very easy and it's very accurate for every one of the atomic levels of a sample, of a material. And that is give you the XPS. More things. It's important to remind that this is a quantum process. And that is important because, because you have, in a quantum process, you have an initial state and a final state. Your initial state is the photon plus the electron in a particular orbital. But you cannot forget about the final state, which is a hole plus a free electron. And what happens about this hole? And that is important because this hole has to be annealed. And how you anneal that is that an electron is going to just to go to cover this hole. This is what is called fluorescence. So once after the photoelectron process, after one electron is emitted, you have immediately after fluorescence. Or either this one or another non-radiative process that is called Auger. Auger is a process in which you cover this hole, but it's not a photon which is emitted, but another electron from here. Energy is also conserved, and you have both channels. So once you have a hole, this hole can be just annealed either by an electron that is coming to cover the hole, and then you emit a photon, or one electron covers the hole, and you emit another electron with the same energy of this photon. So you have these two channels. But these other electrons can be also measured by the same equipment. This is Auger, and they are also specific. So Auger process, as I told you, you have a hole here, for instance, this electron is coming here, and another electron is emitted with just this energy. So also they are tabulated, and it's another way of understanding. It's very characteristic. It's another kind of a spectroscopy, or just spectroscopy. And you have also those peaks that are superposed to the peaks of the XPS that you have in the spectra. Okay, so let's go with this example. We have said that this is a typical spectrum, that in fact what that means is that you have the distribution of electrons for every kinetic energy. or binding energy, right? But then you have these peaks, and these peaks correspond to, as we said, points where you have more electrons or different levels, orbital levels, orbitals on the solid. Okay, so if we identify that, if we go look into this energy and we go to the tables, we see that this corresponds to a gold sample, because you have, this is the gold for F, gold for D, gold for P, and you have here the valence band. This is the Fermi, right? And these are the binding energies inside. So like that, you can have a complete idea of the material. I mean, you have to identify all the peaks that you have in an spectrum, to be sure, because you have other peaks here that they are very representative. If we look to the binding energy of this peak and we make the calculation, we know, well, nitrogen is here, this is small bump, this is oxygen, this is the gold is here, but this is oxygen, meaning that you have oxide on the surface. This is a surface-sensitive techniques, and that means that the information is coming from the surface, and the surface of materials is full of things. I mean, if you have gold in your sample, if you go to the surface, it's never gold, because the last layers, they are fully covered by contamination in a material that I take from air. Only in ultra-high vacuum, you may get rid of all these other features. Always in a real sample, in a sample that is coming directly from air, you will have oxygen coming from oxidation of the surface. You will have nitrogen, mostly as layers of nitrogen that is in some part of the surface, and carbon, a lot of carbon. This peak, in fact, corresponds to carbon, carbon 1s. It's coming from the dust, grease, many other things that are on the surface of the surface. Of a sample. And that is very nice, because this is one of the few techniques that is able to give you presence of contaminants, presence of things that are in very small amount on the surface of materials. But on the other side, it's true that you are losing a lot of bulk information on your spectrum. Okay, if we go, we zoom here, for instance, in this region of the spectra, we see that in fact there are two components. It's not a single component. And there is something else. You see here two bumps, right? What is the origin of that? Okay, as I told you, well, there are, this is a photoemission process. It's a quantum it's a quantum process, and you have final effects. And this final state effects means that for one part, you have a spin orbit interaction, spin orbit splitting. That means that the unpaired electron that remains once you have the hole is going to interact with the angular momentum of the orbital. And that means that you will have just a splitting of atom of depending on the spin of the electron. So you will have this GJ, that is L, the angular momentum plus the spin. And that is the reason why most of the peaks, they have doublets. And this doublet correspond to the spin orbit splitting. And of course, that's valid, but not for L0 when you don't have any angular momentum. That's mean for S orbitals. So in S orbitals, you don't have this splitting, but as well as you go to P, D, or F orbitals, you have this interaction that gives you two components of J. And these two components means that you have a splitting of the peak with a different ratio, but I will not enter in that. That is it's a quantum process. Okay. So how you make the notation of a peak in XPS? You have first the N quantum number, the orbital, then you have the P is the angular momentum, and then you have the J, this L plus or minus the spin of electron. So N, L, J, this is the standard way of making the notation of an XPS peak. Okay. And then the ratio between different components is also depending on this J, and this is a quantum property. And for a P level, one peak is the half of the other. For a D level, this is 2/3. And for a F level, it's 3/4 of a peak, right? Well, with all this information, we can already understand on spectra. This is a gold spectra, a clean surface. So after removing all the contamination, all the different peaks in the high vacuum, all the different layers that you may have hindering your surface. And you see that you have here the 4F, 4D, 4p, the splitting depends on the binding energy also. 4s, there is no splitting. And here you have the Ogepics. And all that corresponds to gold. So this is a gold sample. Here you have the 5p, right? And here is the valence band. So all spectra shall be analyzed, and all spectra shall correspond to the peak that you are analyzing. Okay, but there are other final state effects that you have to take into account. First is what is called shake-up. And that is easy to understand. When an electron is coming out from a material, and this electron, mainly when you have a metal, is going to just to interact with the valence band electrons. So it's going to lose part of the energy. Even some of the energy is going to be used to excite plasmons. So you will see electrons that are coming with the binding, with elastic energy, and then other electrons that have lost part of this energy because this is the plasmon energy. So it's even a way for seeing which are this resonance, this plasmon resonance in a solid. I will show you some examples. But then you have, which is called shake-off, that is a relaxation energy. I mean, you have a hole and you have valence band electrons that are going to move to try to screen this hole. And that means that the binding energy is going to change slightly due to this final effect. So you have all these things together. So understanding the final or the definitive energy, binding energy of a peak is something very difficult because there are a lot of factors that are you have to take into account to really understand the binding energy of the peak. Well, here is an example of what I told you. You have the electrons that are coming with the XPS peak, and then you have some of the electrons has excited one plasmon, another plasmon, another plasmon. So you see all these oscillations. That means the number of plasmons that you have excited. Well, normally this is not so nice and the signal is not so good, but you can do or arrive to see this kind of things. So interestingly, here we have the signal can be quantified. You have one peak, A, is an orbital, right? The signal of this orbital depends on the cross-section, and then some parameters like the flux, the geometrical parameters like transmission of the position, the angle from the sample to the to your detector. So these are geometrical parameters, the transmission at this particular energy, and of course the density, the atomic density of this element. But this is very nice because that allows you, in the simple case, imagine that you have an alloy, an homogeneous alloy of two elements, A and B. If you just make the ratio A towards B, all this part, all this geometrical part, the flux part, all this part will vanish, and you will have just a simple relation. A simple relation that can give you the stoichiometry, knowing the cross-section, of course, but this cross-section, you can find them in tables. So finally, you can have the stoichiometry of the alloy. And it's a very easy way of having this information. Of course, you can make much more complex systems in which you have a layer, for instance. But then if you have a layer, you will have attenuation. You will have a factor here of attenuation and you have to model that. And finally, you can arrive to some numbers. And even though they have some uncertainty in the determination, it's a good approximation, a good idea of the stoichiometry of molecules or other things that you may have. So, which is the photon energy, the nicer photon energy I have to use for an spectrum? Of course, if I use photons with a very low photon energy, let's say ultraviolet photons, with photon energy lower than 50 eV, I am not going to have access to the deeper core level because they have a binding energy much larger and never the electron will be kicked off. It will be just arrive here and back again. So I will not have emission of this electron. So if I use low energy photons, I will have just information about the Fermi level, about the valence band and the states that are close to the Fermi level. And that is very nice using this to enhance the cross section and to have very nice features of the Fermi level. But for photon emission, I don't care much about this region and I care about cold level. So I need photon energies larger than 50 eV. Let's say, just to have just emission of these levels. So we can say that the X-ray photoemission spectroscopy requires photons larger than 50 dB, just to put a number on it. Well, we have seen that it's a technique based on electron detection, and therefore you need ultra high vacuum, and you have surface sensitive information because this mean free path, right? And this is a kind of vacuum system where everything happens. But I told you at the beginning that it's called also ESCA because you are also sensitive to the chemical state. For instance, silicon. In silicon, you have the silicon 2P that appears at 100 dB. On silicon 2S, that appears about 150 dB, right? This is the poor silicon. This is a crystal of silicon, right? But what happens is you have silicon oxide. If you have silicon oxide, you will have just a movement of these levels, because the silicon is oxidized and the oxide have removed charge from the silicon, so it's more bind the state. So instead of 100, you will have 104. Instead of 150, you will have 152. So measuring this precise binding energy, and mostly you can compare with the other one, you can see whether your sample is oxidized or not, which is the chemical state of your sample. And this is very nice. For instance, here we have an example in which they were able to see several suboxides in this material and to identify them. And that corresponds to charge transfer of the atom, to the charge state of the atom somehow, right? But well, in principle, if you have a withdrawal of valence electron charge, you have an increase of the binding energy. I mean, if you have an oxidation, your binding energy will be increased. But if you have addition of valence electron charge, you will have a decrease, a reduction in the binding energy, a reduction process that means a decrease in the binding energy. So this is what is called a chemical shift. There are other factors, as I told you at the beginning, because it's a quantum process. You cannot forget about that, that in some cases, this final state effect can change completely this panorama. But normally, as a rule, as a very important rule, mainly working with very well-defined systems like oxides or semiconductors, increasing binding energy means oxidation process going on. Decreasing binding energy means reduction. So this is a take-home message. And here we have another very nice example with the titanium. Up in the upper spectrum, you see the titanium and metal, and you see how the energy changes a lot when you have titanium dioxide. This is titanium 2P peak, right? And here you have the doublet that I told you before. So it's a very nice technique to understand which is the chemical state of your sample. Here you have another example, silicon and silicon oxide. It's really clear. If you have a clean silicon, and you have silicon oxide, it's the native oxide. Normally, any silicon sample coming from air, you will have the silicon oxide. Once it's in ultra high vacuum, you can sputter, you can anneal, you can clean, get rid of the silicon oxide, and then you will have poor silicon measurements. Or here you have this molecule. This is a very nice example. In this molecule, look at the carbon. How many different carbons they have? Every one of those carbons has a different binding energy for the carbon 1s peak. So the carbon 1s of this will be one different to this one, because here you have two hydrogens and one oxygen here. Here you have three hydrogens plus one carbon. Here you have a double bond to the oxygen. Here you have fluorine. So you have this very nice spectra of the molecule. And look at the intensity of those peaks is similar, meaning that you have one, 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 and one, right? For every one of those, right? So this is the spectra, and then this is assumed here in this part of the spectra, of the carbon 1s peak. Okay, so you see that it would be very interesting to know, to really learn about the chemical state of the sample. And in fact, you have a lot of tables that look into the precise binding energy. You can go here to the table and know, well, which is the reported or the typical configuration of your material, right? There is not all the materials are table, not all the molecules are table, and then you need to make your own references most of the time, because the absolute binding energy depends a lot on this. If you remember in the formula of the energy, there was the vacuum level that could change a lot from one experiment to another, So you have to adjust that to a particular binding energy. Okay. So, okay, this is a kind of a summary. And well, most of the people, I know that most of the people that works with materials, with material immaterial science of this audience, and they are interested in bulk composition. And you may say, okay, this technique is not interesting for me. But it could be. It could be in the moment that you use the technique combined with others, and with others like this sputtering. I mean, if you have this kind of configuration, you have your X-ray source, your electron analyzer, but you could also have pointing to the same place an argon gun. It's what is called death profile. You start to bombard with argon and you start to remove layers at the same time you are making a spectra. And if you plot, for instance, the intensity as the sputter depth or time, you see that the nickel is going down, the chromine is going up, then you have chromine oxide, then you have also oxide, oxygen peak that emerge, you have nickel, nickel going down. So this is a multilayer, and you see that the space from nickel, nickel, chromium, chromium, and silicon at the end, that is the substrate. So you are able to see all the layers you have and the composition of the layers. So this is a very accurate technique to have information about the bulk, right? And also you can correlate whether you have oxide. And something very interesting in this technique is that you can learn about the thickness of the interface. How sharp are the interfaces? If I have a strong diffusion, I will see the nickel signal going like that, whereas the chromium signal going like that, right? If I have sharp interface, I will see something like that, like this here. Of course, the mean free path is not zero, and then I will see always something like that, right? And I will not see a sigmoid, a perfect sigmoid, but something of this shape. Okay, what else? Here we have just a summary. It's a technique that is giving you chemical information, meaning the oxidation state. It's non-destructive because you use X-rays, and X-rays, they are not so destructive as ultraviolet. In the lab, the flux is not so important, so you have very small charge effect, so you can see or look at different semiconductors or even oxides. Measurement could be quite fast, depends on the concentration that you are measuring. If you have small peaks, of course, you have to integrate more and be more time there. But if you have bulk materials, a spectra could be very fast. You can quantify them. I told you just a bit that it's easy to quantify, although you may have a lot of error in the estimation of the things, but it's a very good approximation, mainly to see stoichiometries. And you have a very good sensitivity to the surface. So you can even see over 100 Fa monolayer, mainly with synchrotron radiation. We will go to this part later. But also, well, this is the good things, but there are also bad things. So there is a problem for small areas. I mean, normally you just irradiate or you just analyze 1 millimeter, not nanometers. With synchrotron radiation, you may do that, but not with the standard XPS. Of course, charge effects, although they are small, they are there, and in a moment you may have a lot of problems due to this charging, mainly with samples that are organics. Then you may have a lot of problems. That means that your peak, as you have extra charge, they're going to move. So the precise binding energy and the determination of the element could be compromised. And not only that, also you will have some peaks that become quite wider, much wider. Well, chemical identification is not so easy. And I told you that you will have this movement, and in case of an oxide, it's very easy. In the case of titanium or silicon, is very well established and very easy. But when you go to more complex systems, as could be molecular layers or things like that, the chemical identification could be much more tricky, and you need normally to use references or things that you know similar to the sample that you want to know. Well, an advantage and an inconvenience is that you have only superficial information. And that is in the two sense. I mean, many times you want to have superficial information because there are very few techniques able to give you this superficial information. And for that, it's very nice. Otherwise, you want to have bulk information, and then you need to go to other strategies. And that requires vacuum. And that is an inconvenience and an advantage again. It's an inconvenience because many of the materials that you want to measure could be volatile, degrade in vacuum. And also, as the vacuum is very good and you are using X-rays instead of electrons, you have very few chemical transformation. You may have chemical transformation of your sample, but the fact that you work with high energy X-rays and good vacuum makes that the sample, they are not so affected as in a CEM, for instance, when you have electron irradiation in moderate vacuum, right? So these are available perspectives. And normally in a laboratory, you are using X-ray sources, commercial X-ray sources, that they have a fixed photon energy. So you have a magnesium one, you will have a photon energy of 1,253 electron volts. If you have aluminium, you will have 1,400, silver, 2,800, whatever, right? And those energies are very well tabulated, and you may use for producing X-rays many different anodes in your X-ray source. So this is quite tabulated and quite standard. Every X-ray in the lab have one or two anodes, and these anodes produce a fixed photon energy. Normally, in standard equipment, you will have also satellites due to the process. You don't have the main line of emission, but satellites. Although the new equipments, they work with monochromators to avoid these satellites and to have much more signal-to-noise ratio. But in any case, the intensity can be compromised in this. Okay, but now the good thing is to use synchrotron radiation for making photoemission. You know, for synchrotron radiation is to use these facilities, large facilities. There are several around Europe, and one in Barcelona. We have a couple of them in Italy, France, Germany, all over England, all over Europe. And this synchrotron radiation, the radiation that is emitted from a synchrotron, has several features that makes this radiation special. One is that you have here, this is the emission from binds of electrons that are kept in these particle accelerators. And then through a window, you have the radiation that is emitted, and this emitted radiation incorporate most of the wavelengths. And you can choose with monochromators the wavelength in which you are interested in. And here you have a lot of production of X-rays. X-rays are difficult to produce. In a synchrotron, you produce a lot. Well, you have temporal structure because every time one of those bunches is passing through the window, emits one bunch of photons. But normally for photoemission, you don't need that. You just have a constant. You will see a constant. You integrate that over time. Of course, can be precisely calculated. It's polarized radiation. So there is a lot of advantages, and some of them very important for XPS. So, well, the most important perhaps is the flux for XPS and the tunability. In this third generation facilities, the number, these ones that are now we are building fourth generation, but most of them that are working for photoemission, they call third generation sources. I will not enter on that, but the number of photons emitted is very high. And if you see a typical rotatory anode X-ray tube, you have this kind of brilliance, these units, let's say 10 to the 7, and in a synchrotron radiation, you will have 10 to the 20. So you see, you have a lot of orders of magnitude more of photons. The flux is increased by several orders of magnitudes in this range of energies. You know, it's a lot, right? And what can you do with this? So you can do many things. You can just take this XPS to the limit. For instance, you can vary the photon energy. And that's very important because you can change the kinetic energy and therefore change the sampling depth. And also you can tune for a better cross-section. Let me put some examples. As I told you at the beginning, the depth that you are analyzing depends on the kinetic energy of the electron, of the emitted electron. So if you change the photon energy, right, by the formula of that I told you before, the conservation of energy, then you change the depth. So if you are able to move through this curve, Normally you're moving from here to here. So, but you are able to double the depth, which could be a lot. And also you can tune the photon energy choosing the best one, because also this is tabulated and every level has a particular cross section, as I told you in the formula. If you are looking, you're working with a particular, with the anode of aluminium, for instance, you have a fixed energy here, and then you have a fixed cross section of every level. But if I can move, if I want to detect, for instance, this silicon, if I'm interested in the silicon signal, I have to go low the photon energy, and here is maximum. So I will choose, for instance, for this level to work about 300 dB, and I will have a strong signal of this peak. Whereas in the lab, this peak has, well, it's two order of magnitudes more in cross section. So playing with the cross section is something that you can do. If you can tune the photon energy, and you can only do that on a synchrotron. So you can tune a bit the sample depth, and you can tune the, you can increase or reduce the cross section of your system. High flux. As I told you, in a synchrotron, you have several orders of magnitudes more or photon flux. And that is nice because it helps you to improve the sensitivity and will allow you fast experiments. Let me put some example. This is a very old example in which we were able to deposit on a surface. Here we have a copper bulk, and on top of it, we put some silicon atoms, half a monolayer. So this is a top view, and you see that these are the silicon atoms that intercalate, and they form what is called a surface alloy. So the last layer, exclusively the last layer of those atoms, of this material, of this surface, is just a mixture, it's an alloy. It's a two-dimensional alloy of copper and silver, and silicon. And then you have the bulk. So if you look to the silicon peak in one of those facilities, you see here a very nice result peak. This is a spin orbit splitting. So every component is just a double. And then you see that you have one component and then you have other components. And even though we were able to make a model and to understand that we have the surface alloy, most of them, but also we have double layer and we have silicon islands, and all that gives a small signal. And we were able to relate that. And that is very amazing transparency that was taken on the same system at LIRR. LIRR was a second generation synchrotron radiation facility. So same system at LIRR. LIRR was this old synchrotron. You have this spectra of the silicon peak, right? You see the spectra that is very, you don't resolve any one of the components. At the Eletran, third generation synchrotron facility, you see the same spectra very well resolved because you have much more resolution and flux. Respect to the flux, you see here, the same spectra, after 5 minutes of acquisition time integrating, you have this red line at LIRR, whereas in 50 seconds in Eletra, you have this peak. So this is the huge amount. This is already a synchrotron, second generation, where the intensity was a bit higher of a standard lamp in a laboratory, but let's say a bit higher, but let's say of the same order. But you see the big difference in flux. So you can see smaller things because you have nicer resolution, and you have nicer resolution because you have a lot of counts and you can work in a mode of your analyzer when you resolve much more the peaks. And that's important also in a lab. So in a lab, if you have a non-monochromatic source, a magnesium anode, you see the silicon like that. You are not unable to resolve this spin orbit splitting, as I told you a moment ago. But if you use just in the lab a monochromatic beam, then you are able to resolve very well the spin orbit splitting. Also, the signal to noise ratio is much nicer because you reduce the background a lot. So most of the experiments in most of the labs nowadays, they use this monochromatized radiation. Okay, I will say something about the peak shape that is very complex because, as I told you, it's a quantum process. So the intensity of a peak is not simple. The intensity of a peak, many times you used to put a Gaussian to account for everything. But as long as you increase or have much more sensitivity, it's much more complex process. You have a lifetime. Lifetime is the lifetime of the hole that you are creating, right? So. And this has a width that is convoluted with the Gaussian part. And the Gaussian part accounts for the temperature, the vibrations, phonons that you may have, defects, the science that, as I told you, is very, you have one atom always in a crystal. All atoms are equal. And then the binding energy of those atoms is exactly the same, but you have difference. Close to the difference, the atoms are different. So you have a different charge transfer from this region. So this will have a slightly different binding energy. So that would make that your peak, if you have a lot of defects, will be wider. Excitons you may have. And then you have also a resolution coming from the analyzer and the beamline. In the case of a beamline or the X-ray tube, if you are using an X-ray tube. So finally, this Gaussian part, this broadening of a peak, is not a perfect Gaussian, but it's a Gaussian that is, you have to take into account all that, right? Temperature, phonons, I mean, you reduce the temperature, you reduce Gaussian, you reduce the resolution, experimental resolution, changing the parameters, pass energy, I will not enter, I will not have time. In fact, I'm going quite fast. So reducing all that, you will increase, you will reduce the Gaussian component. And nowadays, in asynchronous radiation, you can reduce a lot this Gaussian process, the Gaussian components, to be compatible or comparable with this lifetime, which is always about 150 millielectron volts, depending on the level, on the material, but normally depends on that. This is about this. So finally, means that you have an intrinsic width of a peak, is the peak distribution. If you want to look like that, your distribution orbital is not just sharp, but has a distribution. This Lorentzian, this is a Lorentzian distribution. So this is the quantum part of the peak that is convoluted with the Gaussian part, right? And the Gaussian part, you can incidence on that. Normally a peak is about 1 eV. And then if you have a lot of defects, then you may have even 2 eV or several species that are together that you cannot resolve. But in a synchrotron, you can go as low as 300 milli-EV. 0.3 of resolution, of width, of a peak. Okay, let me put you another example that you can do it on synchrotron radiation. And this is an example of fullerenes on a surface. Here we have an STM image of those fullerenes deposited on a surface. And they ensemble, they form a crystal, two-dimensional fullerene crystals. You can even grow several layers, right? But what happened now is you have, let's say, about that. About half a monolayer of this material. You have here, this is carbon, we will have a carbon peak, plus a platinum peak, right? You have that on the photoemission. Well, if you anneal this layer, this fullerenes, if you anneal them, of course, with STM, you know that we are going through different phases. Fullerenes, they are suffering a lot of transformation. I will not enter because this is very complex. And finally, they will produce a graphene patches with many other things. Right. You can follow that with photoemission. You can follow that, you have room temperature, the fullerenes, you start annealing, and you see that you have several components. And the point is to understand how these other components evolve. These are the fullerenes, right? And these other components that appear here is give you information about this reactivity or the transformation or how these molecules are breaking down. In a synchrotron, the nice thing is that you can do this kind of images. It's like you take one spectrum, very fast, another, and like that you make an image. And this image you see very fast that you go through several regions. Here the intensity is decreasing, the overall intensity, and there is a shift here corresponding to new phase, and another shift here corresponding to new phase after this temperature. And this is what is called fast XPS experiments that you can do in several beamlines. Everyone, I mean, the trick is to make an spectra, at the same time you have a temperature ramp. And then put that in a kind of two-dimensional image. And you can see and make a phase diagram very easily and distinguish all the transformation of a particular, in this case, a layer on a surface. Okay, improve energy resolution. As you have a lot of counts, you can work in a mode when you have much more resolution. Normally, with analyzers, if you have better resolution, you have less counts, right? It's normal, you understand that to have better resolution, you have to reduce the number of electrons that are going through your electron analyzer through hemisphere. Yeah? It's a simple rule. And then you reduce the number, you increase the resolution, but then you will have less counts. And then there is a moment that you have nearly no counts, right? So it's a balance. In every sample, you need to find out which is this balance, resolution of counts. Now let's go to these molecules. Here you have a molecule, for instance, let's go to the one on the right. We have some nitrogen atoms. Here you have two nitrogen atoms and different carbons. These two nitrogen atoms, they are the same. They are at the same position. I mean, they have the same environment, local environment. So in the molecule, how many peaks I will have for the room temperature? Okay, for the nitrogen, I will have just one because all of them, they are on the same part, this nitrogen. Here is the nitrogen peak, one single component. However, how many peaks I will have in carbon? In carbon, I have carbon close to nitrogen, carbon in the middle, or carbon close to, this is carbon-carbon, and this is carbon-carbon plus hydrogen. So I will have three kinds of carbon. So I will have three kinds of components. If I am able to assign those components, I can follow a chemistry as a function of the temperature and follow a chemical reaction. And here is what happens. We see that this nitrogen is making some transformation because some of them, they are getting into the network. And we have the carbon also that is also suffering transformation. And finally, we have graphene. Most, but some of them, they are bound to the surface and another bound to nitrogen. So like that, we have a very nice tool to follow the evolution of these components just to follow the chemistry of a particular system. Here we have another example from material science. This is a yttrium silicide in bulk, and this is a rare earth silicide. They are all the same family, epitaxially grown on silicon. So we have a silicon substrate here, the red, and then we have planes, different planes of rare earth, silicon, and so on to the surface, and the surface is buckled. So this material is very interesting because it has very interesting properties. And also here, because it's trained, you have vacancies, atomic vacancies in these silicon planes. So if you make high resolution spectra, you are able to identify and to assign every one of the components to every one of the features. The surface atoms, even if they are less, you see them very nicely, one up, one down, right? We have these blue ones that corresponds to the silicon in the planes, and we have this other green that correspond to the silicon in the planes, one close to the vacancies, another far from the vacancies. So we are able to identify all of them. And now what I can do is just to try to vary the angle. And that is important because if I vary the angle, I vary the sample depth. I mean, I said at the beginning that the sample, the Freeman path is what an electron travel before coming out of the solid. If I just look in Gresian incidence, now the electrons that are coming out, they have to have, I mean, they have the same electron, this escape depth is the same, right? But now the depth on the surface is much less, right? Here, I think the sample is clear, right? This is the angle, this is the analyzer, you have an electron coming out, and this is coming from this distance, from the escape depth. But if I tilt the sample, the escape depth is the same, but then the depth from where the electron is coming is much reduced. Okay, so this is a very simple strategy to reduce, to go more surface, to have much more surface sensitivity. Another is to tune the photon energy. And like that, tuning the photon energy, tuning the angle, we are much more sensitive to the components of the things that are on the surface. Okay. And finally, that synchrotron radiation allows you to use another variants, what they call variants. For instance, to use photoelectron diffraction or near ambient pressure photoemission or PIM. So as I have no time to enter because every one of those is a full discipline, just very brief photoelectron diffraction and I will finish. And photoelectron diffraction, as I told you, is very nice because if you have an atom isolated in gas phase, the emission is homogeneous. But if you have atom in a crystal, you will have some focusing due to the presence of photon atoms. I mean, this is the surface, and these are the atoms at the bulk, and the emission of this atom is homogeneous, but when the electron arrives here, it will be a focusing on the intensity when it's passing through or passing close to this. So you will have an enhancement of intensity. And like that, you can triangulate and you can make duration of a surface. Then there are the order of diffraction. Here you have a small features that correspond to several orders of diffraction because electrons, they are waves that are propagating at these energies. And you can take advantage of that just to fully recover your surface. All that is quite well tabulated. And finally, I have that kind of diffractograms that give you the structure. So that's very nice, because XPS is an structural technique, is an electronic technique that gives you the electronics of the surface of the material. But using this photoelectron diffraction, you can convert it in a structural techniques that tell you surface crystallographic directions of your overlayer or your molecules. And this is, for me, it's this very old sample. It's really old, one of the first, but it's very nice. I mean, these people was doing CO on nickel, and they put CO, and they have, and they look to the intensity of the carbon peak. So the intensity of the carbon peak is larger, close to the normal. That means that the CO molecule, carbon and oxygen, should be like that, because the carbon electrons, they are focused by the oxygen peak underneath. So the molecule is standing up. But what happened? When you put more and more dose on the surface, you see that this peak starts to be tilted in two. And that means, in fact, that the molecule tilts. So when you have, you increase the pressure, at low pressure, you have individual molecules, perhaps one don't see another. And then you have this up configuration. But as you pull more and more, the molecules tilt to self-ensemble in this structure that is much more advantageous in the same terms of energy. And then you have this splitting of the signal. And this is the intensity of a peak. So it's a complex process. Again, you can do this kind of diffractograms, and you can find out from here which is the atomic structure of the layer. And just a few words on a technique that is now very, very important. It's this, it's called NAP, near ambient photoelectron spectroscopy. As I told you, you have a sample and the electron has to travel towards the detector. That is why this XPS is done in ultra high vacuum, right? But the problem is that in ultra high vacuum, catalysis is not working the same way that is working at high pressure. So people realize that this information could be partial, and then design a lot of electrostatic lenses or vacuum lenses just to be able to focus and to let the electrons going on even in high or moderate pressure. And with these things, these machines, they're quite complex, you need much more flux, but you are able to follow phase diagrams from one oxygen, I think this is 1 millibar to 10 to the minus 9. And you see this palladium oxidation, how it's changing and going through a lot of different phases. And here you have the XPS, following the XPS intensity of this palladium and intensity from one side, and for other side, binding energies. You are able to build up these phase diagrams as a function of the oxygen pressure. And you find that is something that was not new to these techniques and appears, or synchrotron radiation based techniques, in which you have different phases depending on the pressure. And I think that's all. I have been very fast because XPS is a technique very wide, and I try to make this this talk for be used for every one of you. So that's all. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, José. Thank you for this nice presentation. And of course, I was already convinced about the the XPS. It's really a powerful technique for materials engineering, and you gave us a very good overview of this everything that is related with XPS. Of course, this is a very intensive talk, but I think most probably some persons will have some questions to ask you. I would like to see some raised hand here. Okay. While they are asking, they are thinking about it, I will probably ask you something. Regarding this synchrotron radiation that you start mentioning after explaining first the XPS details, is it possible to add this valence to pre-existing XPS systems? So it's kind of addition to a traditional XPS something that you can buy and add to this kind of equipment?
Synchrotron, of course, you cannot buy a synchrotron. It would be nice. But what you can buy is, you can improve the X-ray shots. I mean, you have a standard XPS. You may use all these variants. Some of those, you can do it with a standard XPS. Photoelectron diffraction can be definitely done with this standard XPS. Photoelectron diffraction is the variations. They are very small, and this is why it's much nicer if you have high flux. But the technique was discovered with the standard XPS. So definitely you can do it. Just need to be able to move your sample in all directions to look for the maximum of intensity. So what you need here is a very well precise sample goniometer to move, to change the angles or with accuracy.
Okay.
Or near ambient pressure photo emission. Nowadays you can buy also the machine, the whole machine. There is much more difficult to adapt an old XPS, but you can buy directly for working in a lab a near ambient pressure photo emission in which they try to optimize everything. So this is more difficult to adapt because the analyzer is the important part is so big here. You need a lot of pumping to have this partial vacuum and all that, but you can definitely do it in a lab.
Okay.
And also PIM. PIM, I have not talked about that, is the way of having photo emission to have maps, photo emission maps, in which you can resolve one particular structure. And these PIM maps also can be done, but the resolution, again, is not so nice as in a synchrotron.
Thank you. These are really powerful techniques. But I would like to have your comment on one particular subject because, okay, regarding the XPS, you obtain the spectra, and then let's say that using after that the software, you can deconvolute the peaks according to your convenience, let's say.
Yeah.
So somehow, when I am, for example, analyzing a sample, analyzing a spectra from a sample, and I start reviewing the literature about similar results, I can find and I can cite articles from according to my needs, let's say.
That's true. Well, I fully understand. Well, I have a rule. When you fit on a spectra, well, I have two rules, let's say, particular. First is that you have to use the less number of components. I mean, if you put a lot of components, of course, you are going to find one that match what you want to see. So use less, use always as less components as possible to fit a peak. Second is that you have to see what you want. I mean, it's very tricky. Many times you see people that they convolve a peak and this discussing a small thing and forget about the rest. So you have to see in the eyes that you have a shoulder, you have something, I mean, some kind of guidance to put there a component. And then references. It's very important to have your own references. That is where is the most difficult part. Because in all that, it's clear that the binding energy is not absolute. There are some agreement about the carbon 1s is 200, whatever, but or the gold. Normally you use the carbon 1s or the gold, right? But even though there is disagreement, every machine is working differently. So the best thing is to have your own references in your own system, to try to think which are systems that you know the composition and that are similar to yours, to use your own references.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's true that it's difficult, the convolution. And normally, I mean, if you have something important, you have to be able to see without a convolution. To see by eyes, because there is a solder or something. If you start the convoluted, you can put many times as components as you like. Another thing important is to use components that have for instance, the width of the component. Of course, you can tune that. You are free to put a component very wide, another very narrow, but this is a trick. I mean, most of the components should have a similar width, because normally they have the same experimental conditions. As you remember, the width of a component is a Gaussian part plus Lorentzian. Lorentzian is always the same for this component, for this peak. And the Gaussian is much more similar, depends only on the structure. So the width should be similar of all of them most of the times.
Okay.
So having this in mind, you need to make a deconvolution of a peak that is reasonable for you.
Thanks. Yes, that's very tricky. Okay. I see that Carlos Rosario wants to make a question.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much for the nice overview of the XPS. I will use this opportunity as I have a lot of experience. I've faced also when doing the fitting that, for example, metallic peaks are not symmetric.
And I
haven't really found out why.
This is a shake-off that I was very fast. And it was the shake-off process. When an electron is coming out, in a metal you have the valence band. So this electron has to interact with the valence band. And it changes energy. So some of the electrons, they are not purely elastic, but they lose a bit of energy due to this sea of electrons that is on the surface.
Right?
So this is the reason why you have this asymmetry towards the low energy side. Mm-hmm. So the region that is close to the Fermi edge is normal. Let's say it's going up normally, but then you have a Q that elongate a lot. More metallic, more elongation. Yes. And this is this kind of interaction of the coming out electrons with the cloud of electrons of the valence band.
Okay, thank you.
So in a metal, always, and this is a mistake in the it's a clear mistake. Many times when you have metals, don't use this elastic part. Many people what do is to put another components there, components, and forget about this asymmetry that you need to include for a good.
Exactly. Yes, so I tried to use that in my own results, and it seems to fit quite well. Instead of using another oxidation state that I think was not really present,
that's
I actually use this asymmetric peak, and it actually helped a lot.
That's right. Yeah, that reduces a lot the part of the oxide peaks.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay. So thank you so much. It was really a privilege to hear your lesson. And I think we need to go move forward to the next speaker. Thank you again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.